shove this out of the way. So, okay, I'm a physicist, I'm not an ecologist, but what I'm going to talk about are kind of fundamental properties that come from the fact that physical quantities have dimension. And this provides a useful tool, which is called Buckingham's Pi theorem, formal dimension analysis, which you can apply to anything that has dimension. And so we're going to push this a bit and see if we can say something about, you know, ecology and other kinds of systems. Okay. So I'm going to talk about ideas that kind of, as a physicist, the ideas of sort of control parameters. I'm not going to produce a model, but I'm going to be at the step before that, where you actually find what the relevant dimensionless parameters are for systems and how you do that. So I'm going to introduce that kind of ideas, show you some examples of how it's done, talk a little bit about ecology, and then maybe like there's a Reynolds number for life. I mean, that's the idea I'm throwing out there at the end, okay? So, yes. So it's not working. He's disappeared. So, yeah, look, it's just not, it doesn't fall.
It's not advancing.
No.
If we push this one.
No, so. Well, it's because. Well, maybe
you're
if I. It's, oh, is there a laser clicker? No, he didn't set that up, so that doesn't. Yeah, it's not doing. I don't know what it's doing. Yeah, okay. So we're going to try the clicker, apparently. Does that work? So try advancing it. Oh, great. Finally. Great. Fine. Thank you. Okay. And I get a laser pointer for free, all books of things. Don't know how to make it work, though. Is this a laser pointer? No. Okay. So to give you just the idea, where physicists are coming from is this idea of universality. And it's the idea that you don't need to include all the details under certain circumstances. All right. So just to talk about something simple, I'm just talking about the pendulum here. If you think about a pendulum, is this the... No. No, okay. I don't know where the pointer is, he didn't tell me. Where's the pointer? That's all right, I'll just keep talking till I'm done. No, that doesn't work either. No, I don't know. I'll just point with my fingers, it's all right. Okay, so... so you have a pendulum. And we want to know the period of the pendulum, okay? And so, here's my pendulum, and if I know everything about it, I can write down equations for it. I can say, okay, there's a force, and I can resolve the tangential force, and I can say, okay, there's gravity, and I can equate them, you know, F equals ma, and so forth, and get some kind of expression. Okay, so I knew about the system, I knew what equations to write down. And you end up with something where there's a number, the frequency, that tells you about the pendulum, all right? The important thing is I can say, okay, let me think about small perturbations, small oscillations around zero, where theta is the, you know, angular perturbation of the pendulum. And if I do that and expand it, I basically get a potential that's shaped like this. And so what this actually tells you is anything that has a potential that's shaped like this, if I'm close enough to its minimum, it will look like a pendulum. So it doesn't need to be a nice pendulum with a bob and a string and all these things. So this is the idea. If I don't need to know all the details of the system, I just need to be close around this point, and I know it will follow this equation or an equation like this one. And then the only thing I need to know is the frequency. So there's a parameter that tells me what kind of pendulum it is, you know? The only other thing I'll point out, because we'll come back to this, you'll notice early on, we noted there was mass on both sides, that I said, okay, the pendulum had mass, but, you know, F equals ma, so the m's cancelled. So the mass is not important in the problem. But to get that from here, I had to write the equations down. Okay, so bear that in mind for later. Okay, no, this thing. Right, so how do we get the parameters? I mean, things like the frequency. These problems that you just need to know what the number is. And this is what this talk is all about, how you do this without having the equations to write down. Okay, so here's an example. This ought to do for this lunch faff that we have here every day, okay? But if you go to a conference and you want the coffee, right? So people are going to the coffee, and the question is, how easy is it to get the coffee at the conference? And there's a dimensionless parameter that I'm going to propose for this problem, and it's based on desire, okay? So there's a desire for knowledge. You want to chat to people, but there's also a desire for coffee. And if the desire for coffee exceeds the desire for knowledge, everybody will just go to the coffee, and this will give you an ordered motion. Everybody just goes there. But if the desire for knowledge is larger, then everybody chats, and it takes ages to get the coffee, and the motion is quite disordered. So there's a transition between order and disorder, and there's a parameter that tells you where you are. Without any knowledge of the details, I didn't include any details, I didn't say what kind of conference it was or what kind of people, anything, even how good the coffee was, okay? So there is, that is this idea, the details don't matter, but something like this, a transition, you can study it by just knowing what the right parameter is to study it. Right, this is going to mess in my head all the time. So I'm going to give some examples, and here's a nice one. It's not a physics example. It's people, ecologists here may know about flocking models. They've heard of this V-check model. I don't know, has anybody heard of it? Yeah, some people have, okay. It's not a very good model, but it's a nice toy. And the way it works is that your little birds move around, and they move at constant speed because they're flapping their wings, okay? And they have to decide what to do at each time step. So when you make a step, you introduce a random perturbation in the direction, okay, which is the d theta. But you also look around you at the other birds around in radius r, and so you add on sort of the average motion of the other birds. So you can see there's a competition here between following all the other birds if the noise is low, the fluctuations, or just randomly walking if the fluctuations dominate. Then you've got these two possibilities, like the people going for their coffee, okay? And you can get different behaviours, and I'm going to try and show them. If I don't think this is going to work. It did work when I set it up, but okay. So what I'm going to show you, so this is where the noise dominates, okay? And so you can see all the birds just randomly just do their own thing. They just make random walks. And if I ask for the average speed of all the birds, it will be close to zero, not exactly zero. And if I start to reduce the noise, some interesting stuff starts to happen. They start to kind of flock. So there's a value of the noise in the middle where they all start to follow each other and you get some interesting dynamics. And then if I go even further, so this is now low noise, you can see they all start to follow each other and now there's a net speed. If I add up the speed of all the birds, they're all going off in one direction. So there's a transition from average speed zero to average speed in one direction or other, okay? And there's a parameter that takes you from one to the other. And it didn't really depend much on the details of these birds. So there's other parameters in the problem, though. Okay, there's the noise. So we're going to think about what to do about that, okay? But just for the moment, what I've told you is there's an order parameter, a parameter that tells you how ordered the birds are. And you can talk about different things. You can talk about the average speed, or you can talk about, people talk about susceptibility. There's papers on this, okay? Which is V squared, or you can do something like look at the mutual information. This was something we did. So you just have data and you want to decide how flocking they are. You can calculate the mutual information between the bird trajectories. And again, that will tell you where you are you ordered or disordered? So you can find an order parameter that tells you what they're doing. And then there's a kind of control parameter which has something to do with the noise, but other things as well. And that's what we want to find. So this is an example of something we'll look at. Okay. So how do we get these parameters? This is what this is all about. Not the model, but the parameters. So I'm going to talk about similarity analysis. How do you get the parameters without writing down the model? Now, for the pendulum, I wrote down a model for it. I wrote down the simple equations, but I'm not going to be able to do that anymore. So the power of this is, how can you get the parameters when you, in fact, can't get the model at all, or it's difficult to do? That's when it's useful. Okay, so some examples. This is quite an appropriate one. It's stuff they used to do up the road, okay? You know what this is. But this is a water drop turned upside down. So the scales are very different. You know, this is huge. This is like on this scale, okay? And yet you can see the solution, which is a wonderful non-linear sort of solution of this thing, you know, rising up. looks pretty similar. So the only way you know that these things are different are the numbers, okay, the parameters of the system. What I'm going to show you, the Pi theorem, was actually used by G.I. Taylor to calculate the yield of the first atomic bomb that went up on the road here. At the earlier stage in this, when the thing is just kind of spherical and it's just got a shock wave. So that's kind of a nice thing. He actually used Pi theorem to do it. I'm not going to do that now, okay? Okay, so another example, you can look at this. This is, again, a little water drop experiment. So there's a flow going along here, and there's a little obstacle. And so you produce these lovely vortex streets. This is kind of a sandbank thing. This is a little island, so it's a picture from a satellite and the clouds. So very different scales, but very similar solutions. So the question is, well, why are they so similar? Yeah. This one, so there's a kind of river outlet, so it's like muck, basically, in the sea. So that's producing this lovely swirly pattern. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So... okay, so what could be going on? And there's actually two things, so we have to be a little bit careful. So this problem was, I think, first looked at by Struhal, and he talked about aeolian tones. It's the noise that telegraph wires make when the wind blows over them. You know, they make a kind of humming noise. And what it is the telegraph wire is vibrating as it's shedding these vortex streets. So when he constructed his Struhal number, he actually talked in terms of the frequency rather than the scale of the pattern. But what the Struhal number is, actually, if you unpack it, is actually the ratio between the size of the thing, which is the width here, okay, and the distance between the different vortices, so the shape of the pattern, okay, and that's your Struhal number. So when I showed you all those things, they had the same Struhal number. It's a dimensionless number, even though they're all very different, okay. And then the question is, why are they the same? Well, it could be that they have the same kind of numbers all scaled up, but it could be something else. So what happened was, once this data was available, you know, Rayleigh showed that you could actually use the dimensional analysis that I'm going to show you. And the way to order the data was to plot Struhal number against the Reynolds number. What the Reynolds number is, which I'm going to spend more time on, it's the ratio of the energy you're putting into the flow. So it's flow speed times the size of the object, or the length of the driving scale over the dissipation. And what's actually going on is, you can see over several orders of magnitude, the Struhal number doesn't change. So you've got two possible reasons why these things all kind of look the same, or why they scale one to the other. Either the dimensionless parameters are the same, the things are different, you know, so like the exploding atomic bomb cloud, you know, you double the size of the cloud, but you double the energy, or you cube the energy, or whatever it is, you scale everything up. Exactly the same dimensionless parameters, it just scales up. Or, in fact, there's insensitivity to one of the parameters, which is what's going here. There's a big range of Reynolds number over which the Struhal number is the same, so the pattern looks the same, and that's why the island looks the same as the little water drop experiment, okay? But the key thing out of this is, to figure this out, you need to plot your data in terms of the dimensionless parameters, so you need to know what they are. Because once you know this, I could look at all these different experiments, and as you can see what's going on here, these are all plotted for different D, so different size, and they all lie on the curve. Okay. If you didn't have the dimensionless parameter, if you just plotted it versus D, you'd get a mess. So this is kind of where it feeds into maybe the ecology. You know, there may be some better dimensionless parameters to plot ecological data, and maybe we could find these. Okay. This is also, I mean, why do I know this stuff? Because I'm a plasma physicist and I do simulations. If you want to put something on the computer and it's expensive, you don't want to repeat it many times. But if you know that this experiment is the same as this one, scaled up, there's a lot of less experiments you've got to do on the computer. So it's fundamental to doing these kinds of calculations as well. Okay, so this is the basic idea. Right, so we're going to actually do it now. So this is Buckingham's Pi Theorem, 1914, so it's been around a while. And basically the idea is that if you have a model for a system, a physical model for a system, it's a physical system, it should not care what units you're working in, okay? So if I write down my model F, and it's a function of variables that have physical units, these Qs, okay? Whatever variables I think are important. This F really must depend on things that are dimensionless, because it shouldn't matter how I make the measurement. Okay, this is a kind of key thing. And this is Pi theorem. So I know, even if I don't have the solution F, and I'm not going to find the F at the end of this, you're not going to get the F, okay? But what you are going to get are the pi's, which are the dimensionless things inside the F. Now, if I get those, and then I have some other piece of information, things like maybe there's conservation of some quantity, then maybe I can say something about F. But I still haven't got a model, so you never get to the stage of writing equations down, but you get to learn a lot about the system. How many of these groups are there? Yeah, go. Yes, yes, and this is kind of really, you've hit on the most interesting point of my whole talk, because it will turn out in ecology, some things have no dimension. So what this does is constrain things that have dimension, as we'll see, okay? That, you know, you list these cues and you think these are my important things and they have to form these dimensionless groups. If things have no dimension, I can't do that. And in ecology, this is why I think this is interesting. You've got both things going on. In physics, everything has dimensions, pretty much. But in ecology, we're going to be talking about species and things, and they don't have dimension. Yeah.
Are there any quantities in ecology that are not, if you like, information quantities? Because, you know, they might not be physically, they might not be measured in physical units, but they're still...
But that's fine. Those are what I'm talking about, the pies.
Yeah.
Dimensions cancels out. Yeah, that's exactly.
So, but you're saying like information things that, well, they don't have any physical quality, but they fit the pies in, right?
Well, we don't know how, they're not obviously covered by this rule that physical quantities have to be expressible and dimensionless.
They're not constrained. Let me show another slide. They're not constrained by the Pi theorem. That's the point, because they've got no physical dimension. But let me show you an example. Okay. So the one thing you need to get from this is, of course, if I've got a bunch of Qs, quantities, I can form as many groups as I want. But there's a kind of minimum number, right? And that's what the Pi theorem says: is if you've got x quantities and y physical dimensions, things like mass, length, and time, then there are at least z dimensionless groups, or dimensionless quantities, ratios, which is what you're talking about. Of course, you can always make more, all right, by multiplying them together and things. Okay, so to come to this business, I think as we go, it will become a bit more clear how this is working. So I'll start with the pendulum again, all right? So now we don't know the equation of motion of the pendulum, but we want to know what the period is, okay? So what we do is we say, okay, I'm going to write down all the things I think matter about the period. And so the game is you write down the thing you want, which is the period, then you write down all the other things you think the theory of period might depend on. And maybe I think it's the mass or the angle or gravity or whatever. And now this is the thing to bear in mind. You're going to immediately say, well, why did you pick those things? I want to add another thing. And so a lot of what I want to do is show what happens. Think of it as a tool that you, if I put my things as an input and see what comes out, and then I mess with it, okay? So say we go with these things, and there's five of them, okay, and there are three dimensions, mass, length, and time. So two groups. Sorry? What was it? Oh, well, yeah, I never figured it out. That one, which one? Oh, that little button. You can see that, yeah, is that better? Yeah, it's better for me. So I just couldn't find it. Okay, yeah. So there are two. So this one, the angle of release, the angle, theta, of course it's in radians, so I'm going to put that on its own. And then we're left with L over G squared tau. There are two of them, okay? So the solution, I'm going to say, well, it's the function, I don't know what F is, of these things. Must be some constant, and constant, I don't know what it is, okay? I'm going to do that to try and make something. So that isn't much help. So I'm going to say, okay, let's look at a subset of things where f of pi 1 is pi 2, okay? So, you know, f of, you know, theta is the other guy, is root L over g. And so this, and then if I rearrange that, the simplest solution I can find is that the period, you know, I've said these things separate, is f of theta, which is the details of the pendulum, and then the period, okay? Oh, and you'll notice the mass didn't appear. Now, we knew this before when I wrote the equations down. I said, oh, look, the mass cancels, and I knew that because I knew what the equations were. But now this tells you the mass doesn't appear without knowing the equations. So this is quite a powerful idea. So when you're deciding how many things do I write down and what do I add, in your mind is, if I add a new thing, I've got to be able to match its dimensions with the other guys. Otherwise, it can't appear in the problem. And that's quite a powerful constraint in itself. I think that's one of the most powerful things. What is important in my model or my system? Okay, so mass is on its own, so I can't make a dimensionless quantity out of it. So it can't be important. I'll throw it out. Okay, so this gives me the result that the period goes like root L over G. Now this F, I don't know what it is. And in fact, it's different for different kinds of pendula. The conservative pendulum would have a different solution to the damped pendulum. So if I put in some extra information like it's conservative, I conserve energy, I can get this F. I'm not going to do it, but you can solve the whole problem. So at this stage is where you put something else in that you know, which is what we're going to do. Okay, so this is kind of the idea. What can you get without knowing the model? So what about the flocking birds? So now we knew it was the noise. I said, okay, obviously if you vary the noise, you see different behavior. If you make it, you know, the noise is the how big the changes in direction of the birds are at each time step. The birds are all flying around constant speed, changing their direction. And so the noise is how big that direction changes. And so as I vary the noise and fixed everything else, you've got this transition from completely random motion, birds ignoring each other, just doing little random walks, and completely coherent motion. But we know there's other things in the problem, and so I'm going to do this now and write them all down. So there's the noise, there's the bird speed, obviously, okay. Then there's this business of this interaction radius. The rule was they change their direction, but they also look around within radius r and they take the average direction of all the other birds. And it's on the computer, so there is in fact a time step, characteristic time. And there's a density, how many birds are there, you know, in a certain radius or whatever. And now you could add more. This implies it's an infinite box, okay? You could say the box size, and that matters too, but I'll just go with this for the moment. So five things, two dimensions, length and time. So three groups. One is, again, it's got no units, it's the size of the random fluctuations. And then the other two, one UDT, that's how far a bird goes in each step of the calculation. And that's compared to R, the radius. So if you think about this, if the birds are going like crazy, they're going really fast, they don't stay within a radius of all the other birds, so they never really get correlated motion going. Whereas if their speed is very small compared to the radius, they hang around with their friends' radius, okay? So that's that parameter. The density and the interaction radius tell you how many birds are within the interaction radius. If there's hardly any birds, if you're all on your own, it doesn't matter that you look around. You don't find any other birds, so you just do a random walk. But if you look around and you see a lot of other birds, it really affects your motion. So that's what these parameters are telling you. And then what you can do, and we did this, okay, we can say, okay, we've got this transition. We now know the space we need to look in to tell us about the transition. And that's what we're plotting here, this pi 1, pi 2, pi 3. And these contours are just where the transition is, and we found it by looking at the susceptibility, okay? Or you could look at mutual information of the trajectories, or a bunch of things you could look at, okay? Hello. Okay, I'll keep talking. Okay, right. So the point about this is, this tells me how many times I need to run the simulation to know everything about the system. Everything I need to know about the system is contained in this space. So rather than just, I'll just run loads of numbers and see what happens. Okay. These are macroscopic variables. They're not telling me anything about the details of the behavior, and yet they tell me where the transition is. So this is a kind of way you can analyze. Yeah, is there a question? No. No, it's because I'm looking at the contour of the order parameter. Okay. I just plotted the contours because you're going from one value to another. That's all it is. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's all it is. So, you know, it's powerful in terms of doing the computation, but it's powerful in terms of knowing, if you've got data, how to order your data. What coordinates do you really want to plot in to know you've seen everything, all the behavior of the system? Okay. So now I want to warm up to this idea that's going to come to ecology. I want to talk a little bit about turbulence, okay? I want to give you a flavor for when you can actually get a model out of Pytherium. Sometimes you can. This is an example. And then I want to talk about Reynolds number a little bit and then go to the ecosystem idea, because I kind of got it from turbulence, because that's all I really know about, okay? So this is when things are really good with Pytherium, okay? Say we want to know, for a fluid, it's an incompressible fluid, we want to know the power spectrum, okay? We want to know the energy spectrum. We want to know E of K. So this is the energy per unit wave number. And we would like to know this for turbulence, and I can't solve the problem of turbulence. Okay, and now what I'm going to do, this is quite a nice thing, I'm going to say, my definition of turbulence is it does not depend on the details of the dissipation. See, what you're doing is you're driving eddies, you're stirring a fluid on some length scale L. You drive a big eddy, it turns over, it breaks up into a smaller eddy and smaller and smaller and smaller eddies until you get to a dissipation scale, and then it terminates, it dumps energy into the system. And there's all sorts of physics in the dissipation, but I'm going to say turbulence doesn't care as long as dissipation happens. And that's what my definition of turbulence. So I'm not going to write dissipation in my column. I'm just going to write E of K, the rate at which I'm driving it, the rate of energy input, and the wave number, because E depends on K. Okay, three things, two dimensions, because I left out mass, okay, because it's incompressible. So there's only one group, and this is really handy, and this is the group that you can form, so it goes like E cubed K fifth. Okay. And then I say, well, what if we just assume that this thing is a constant and churn it out? And immediately out comes, you know, K goes to the minus 5/3. So the dimensions are enough, the physical dimensions are enough to tell you what Kolmogorov exponent is. As I say, if you start putting other things in that break it, you start putting in details of the physics, you'll get other stuff and you won't get this nice relationship anymore. So this is a kind of way of defining what turbulence is and getting some information out, solving it, in fact.
This doesn't work.
None. Yeah, yeah. Well, no, because you haven't said anything about the dimensions of K. And furthermore, well, I'll show you. Yeah, exactly. You've got to put more stuff, right? You've got to do this. You've got to do something like this. Yeah, okay. That's right. I mean, okay. So you've got to put something extra in. I mean, I didn't use that example. I used this example because I'm a plasma physicist. But yeah, if you start knowing about, so MHD is a nice example of this as well, with a magnetic field in it. Okay. So you put something, this is what happens. You put something else in. So this is what I did. Okay, you add something else. You could add the fact that there's a magnetic field direction that makes it 2D, or the thing that makes it 2D. Or you could add the fact that in MHD turbulence, there's a characteristic speed, which is the Alphane speed. But you put something else in to tell it. And then when you do that, of course, we now have four quantities. So we've got two dimensionless parameters. One is the one we had before. And the other is the new thing that involves the thing I added. And now I don't immediately get Kolmogorov out anymore. And in fact, if I say, and to do something, I say, okay, well, I observe scaling. So I'm going to say pi 1 goes like pi 2 to the something. If I do that, then I get something like this, but I don't know what the alpha is. And that's the whole point of MHD turbulence or 2D turbulence or any of these things. So you now get an exponent, and it could be different depending on whatever. Okay, exactly. So this is kind of, I mean, I did this. It's good that you asked, because it's quite an important point of what you put in. You get out what you put in. Yeah. Okay. So hopefully. I don't know.
He
did get. Well, yeah, he we'd have got out the solution. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, it was just, yeah, you just match the total energy density and the Mach number. Yeah, basically. Yeah. Oh. Is it going to come back? Okay. So one more of these, and then I'm going to do some ecology. This is a bit complicated. I'll just get the idea, all right? It's just because I'm going to talk about Reynolds number. So just to tell you what the Reynolds number is in turbulence, really. So again, now what I want to do, remember I mentioned Reynolds number before and I said it was relating the driving to the dissipation in turbulence, okay? So now I'm going to make a different list. I'm going to include a driving scale, a dissipation scale, the driving bulk flow speed and the viscosity, okay? And if I do that, then there are four things. I've neglected the mass. I mean, you just, okay? And so there will be two parameters to find. And one of them is this Reynolds number, which tells you about the driving. So U is the velocity of the stirring, L is the scale on which you stir, and this is the viscosity. And the other one is the ratio of the driving scale, the long scale, to the dissipation scale. And so this is just to give you the flavour of it. What we want is to know how these things are related, because what this is really telling you is how many modes or how many degrees of freedom am I exciting? Because what happens is I drive it harder and harder, the power spectrum gets broader and broader. I'm exciting more and more modes in the system because I've got more energy available to do it. Okay. Oh, is it going to come back? So. Okay. All right. So just to get the idea, I'm not going to be able to go for it with it flapping around. We can talk about the number of degrees of freedom or the number of excited nodes or the number of places to park energy, which is what we're talking about here, is given by this ratio of length scales. Then I have to put some things in to get anywhere. And one is to say I observe scaling, it's turbulence. So these degrees of freedom go like n to the something, whatever, I could just choose something. And the other, and this is the key thing, it's you can't have energy piling up. So I put energy on in one scale, I stir the fluid, and then the eddies break up into smaller and smaller and smaller eddies. But the rate at which energy is transferring from one scale to the next, on average, is constant. If it isn't constant, energy will just heap up on one of the scales. Okay. So this energy is flowing through, and so then I can say, all right, the energy transfer rate on any scale is u cubed over r because it's u squared over t. Okay, energy injection rate, and the r is the radius of the eddy, okay, length of a time, okay, matches the injection rate, which matches the dissipation rate. This comes from the fluid equations, okay, and so I can relate the Reynolds number to the number of degrees of freedom. So what this tells you is the harder I drive it, the more degrees of freedom I get, the broader the power spectrum, the more wave modes I've excited. And that is the key idea that I want to use, okay? Now, I mean, I can talk about how you do this all in detail, but that's the key idea. So we assume that on average, the energy transfer rate is constant. Okay, so now, I didn't say anything. I mean, the whole thing here, there's no detail at all, okay? So I said, okay, we could talk about energy coming from the larger scale, and these are the eddies breaking up into smaller, smaller, smaller things. The energy finds its way down somehow. Okay, and the transfer rate, the rate at which you put energy through each of these length scales has to match on average. It can fluctuate around a little bit. But I could easily have gone the other way. I could have said, I'll actually pump the energy in on the really small scales, and then they kind of stick together and, you know, they form more and more coherent structures, which is the inverse cascade idea. Oh. Either of these things could be true, okay, because I didn't, nothing that I did told you which one it was, okay. So this is the idea for the ecosystems, that you're going to provide energy into the system, into small little creatures, and then they're going to give their energy to bigger creatures and so forth. Okay. Right. Oh. Oh, no. No. Is he gone? Hello. Go, yeah, go to the next one, go on. No. So, yeah, you might as well get some food. I mean, or I'll catch you up. I kind of need the slides, I'm sorry. Is it going to work soon? just to kind of continue. So maybe you can see where I'm kind of going with this. That, you know, we're gonna talk about an ecosystem. That's it. You might have to come out there. Yeah, no, you just got to get to the next slide. Great, okay. Okay, so what we're going to do is what I just did, but for ecosystems, treating them like the inverse cascading turbulence. That's what we're doing, okay? So no model, but quite a lot of information will come out about the ecosystems, which should then kind of be part of models for ecosystems. I mean, this is the take-home, right? If we come up with dimensionless parameters that are the right ones, they have to be in your ecosystem model somehow. And if they're not, or if they don't work, then we learn something. So this is the idea. Okay, so it's a very naive idea about the ecosystem. I mean, you see the guy saying, hey, wake up, you're holding up the food chain because the cat's asleep, all right? This is just but it's the idea of energy flow. But so a few things we're going to have to kind of nail down now. And I'm going to start talking about, okay, it's obviously not this simple, right? So I'm going to talk about what we've actually got. And I'm going to talk about two things. I'm going to talk about kind of, and I never know the right words because I'm not an ecologist, so I'm going to kind of talk about categories. So like a finch is a category or an elephant is a category. And then there are species of finches and species of elephants. So they're going to be categories and they're sitting in the web somehow. They're all linked together, so they all get a share of the energy flowing into the ecosystem. This defines the ecosystem. How do you know you're in it or not? You get a share of the energy somehow. Okay, the energy gets in somehow through the primary producers, the little things at the bottom. Okay, and then it kind of finds its way around. Okay, it doesn't matter what the resource is. I'm going to talk about sunlight. Okay, it could be something else. The minute I start doing things, people say, yeah, but there's losses and things recycle and all sorts of complicated things happen. I'm going to say, I don't care. I'm just going to, as long as I know a fraction goes in and it percolates through, and then there's going to be some alpha in front that says, okay, we lose 50%, then that's fine. But, you know, you can think about if you've got sitting there burningly saying, no, I want to put this detail in, what that would do? Would that be an important thing or not? It's just the question to ask. Okay. And here's the cool thing. It's not an equilibrium. Okay. It really is not an equilibrium. It's like the turbulence. The turbulence is not an equilibrium thing. It's driven and it's dissipating and it hovers around a steady state. Okay, this is a really important thing. So I don't know a lot about ecology, but I do see ecology talks and they all talk about equilibrium and food webs and static food web dynamic. This system I'm imagining is extremely dynamic. Species can come and go. Things can come and go. They can all move around, but the energy flow is the thing that's controlling everything, and it flows through the system in a way that on average it's in a steady state. Okay. And that implies a thing about timescales that the system can adapt. If you did change the amount of energy going in and out, the system can adapt to it. Okay. So, and what we will get out is some clues to why you see patterns. So you see all these patterns in ecology, okay? Things like, you know, patterns to do with density, i.e. the number of individuals and the mass, patterns to do with species area, all these kinds of things. Now, I'm not going to be able to tell you exactly what these functions are, but I can tell you what kind of patterns you should be seeing. Because if you've got a dimensionless parameter, as you say, it's a dimensionless ratio. If you increase this up one guy, then you should increase the other guy. It's that kind of a pattern. So we're going to get the general sense of it out, but not the detailed model. Okay. So I'm going to just go through this now. So there's basically three things I need to do, and I'll just go through them. Okay, they are, I'm going to kind of try and nail this idea of finches and elephants. What do I mean by category? You know, how loose is that definition? What do I mean about resource flow into the system? How do I talk about that? And characteristic length scales. You could add to this list, I'm sure, but I'm just going to talk about these three things. But just bear in mind, I could add to this list. Adding to it would kind of look like the same kind of thing, the same kind of manipulation as what I'm doing here, okay? But just, this is kind of enough to give you an idea of how it works, okay? And it's in this dynamically balanced steady state, assuming that the thing, if I changed the rate at which I put in the energy or changed some external conditions, the thing can react quite quickly, Okay, so it keeps this balance going. You know, if I turned up the sunlight or whatever, this thing just reacts accordingly. This is really important because it means if the result at the end, and you apply it to data, and I'll show you how to apply it to data, if it doesn't work, it means this something's wrong with your ecosystem. So at the end, this could be something that tells you my ecosystem's not in balance anymore, the animals are all dying or something, okay, it's collapsing. So it could be something that tells us about that, without a model. Okay, and it's because you need this kind of idea for the ecosystem to just sit there not happily doing its stuff. Okay, so the first thing is, I'll talk about this idea of a category, and there are different ways you could do this. So I'm just picking a way of doing it, and there are different ways. And I'm saying, well, if we observe something like finches, our category has to have the property that I can talk about an average. Okay, there's an average kind of size of a finch. And you might imagine categorizing things in a way that didn't do that, but you kind of need that to work, okay? Yeah, that if you go and measure them, you're gonna get an average that's meaningful. An average of what? Okay, I'm gonna go for, just because it's simple, that I'm gonna count the number of cells, I'm gonna talk about the size in terms of number of cells. You could have talked about the body mass, and then you'd have to introduce a characteristic mass, or you could talk about the height. You could do this in different ways and make it more interesting. This is just the simplest thing I could think of. Okay, so my finches have a characteristic size, they have a characteristic density, abundance or whatever, a characteristic richness, number of species of finches, and metabolic rate R per cell. Okay, so they have this property. Okay, and then there'll be finches and there'll be foxes or whatever, and they'll all have this kind of stuff going on. Okay, and they're all connected together. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, so the finches are kind of sitting somewhere in a web. They are connected in. This is the main point, that stuff, energy is coming into the system somehow, and they're connected, and this defines kind of what I mean by an ecosystem. And of course, this is the point about dimensional and dimensionless variables. I might choose to count finches, or I might choose to count like birds, you know. So I could, finches was like one little box, birds could be several boxes. You know, the way I choose to count them, and that kind of tells you something about my data, so I need to think about that, okay, will determine how it works. As long as I know what I'm doing, it's fine, I just need to know, okay. So that's why there's going to be dimensionless parameters in there about species and things, because if I counted birds instead of finches, and I looked at species, I'd get a different answer. So that kind of, the numbers like that will come out, and that's what these dimensionless things are doing. And those are the things I can't control with pi theorem because they haven't got any dimension. But they, you know, they depend on how you talk about your data, which I think is kind of interesting. Okay, so there's that, how the resources get in. And then it matters on the length scale you measure, of course. And this is a kind of bleeding obvious example that if you look at a bit of coral, you know, you can and count the polypy things, you know, you get a different answer if you look over the whole reef. So we have to kind of build this in, okay? This reflects non-smoothness of how things are dispersed in the ecosystem. So I'm going to include that. So I say there's other things you could include. This will tell you how to do it. Okay. Right. So this is the whole problem done more or less, or most of it, all in one go, and then I'll kind of break it up into pieces so you can see how it works, all right? So if I just take all those things I just said, and I said these are the important things in the ecosystem, you can change it, but if I do it that way, here are the things, and I will list them. So I talked about the body size, and I talked about it in terms of number of cells. I already normalized it to something, okay? As I say, you could put mass in kilograms or something here, and then you'd have another guy which is like a typical mass of something, a mouse or you think it's a gram or the smallest thing that's viable, you'd put that in and you'd have another parameter. So I'm just doing this to make it a bit simple, or you could define it in a slightly different way. Okay, there's, now I'm talking about this P category. P means it's the finches, okay, or it's the elephants or whatever. So it's the body size, the mean density, the number of species that you see, the metabolic rate that you get. So another assumption here is that every cell in every organism takes the same amount of metabolic rate to drive it. Of course, that's not quite true, but that's just a kind of rough thing to, on average, you know, and then we can make it more complicated. Then there's the stuff coming in, energy supply per unit area. I'm going to put a fudge factor in, which is dimensionless, because there are losses, okay? I'm not going to do anything with it, but just as a flag to tell you, yes, there are losses. Okay, and then because we wanted, yeah. Well, yeah, but it's also that you're losing. Animals just radiate heat out, so they. I mean, the trivial example, you know, you're pumping energy into the system, and the elephants just get hot and they just radiate heat out. You know, the finches get hot, and so the energy just is lost at every scale. And there are all sorts of complicated ways that the thing is not efficient. So I can't just assume that the rate at which I stuff energy in is the rate at which energy is supplied to the whole ecosystem. There are losses, and that it's complicated. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Well, exactly. If they just die and it doesn't feed back into the system, yeah, that's another loss. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm not going to go into... Again, this is the question. How detailed does that need to be to describe my ecosystem? And I'm going to go for not at all. See what you get out. And then you might say, oh, no, actually it matters, and start putting these things in. Exactly. This is kind of what I'm trying to do. Okay. So the last thing is, and I'll add this at the end, is this business that it matters that things are not uniformly distributed, okay? So if I take all that lot, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 things, mass, length and time, 5 groups. So these are going to be the things you need to know about ecosystems, and they are something that looks like a Reynolds number, because what this is the energy going in, okay? Let's say sunlight shining on a surface, so PL squared. This is the metabolic rate, the rate at which you have to give energy for one cell. And alpha is this efficiency thing, okay, things die or, you know, just natural death or whatever. So this is like a Reynolds number. And so this is like the control parameter of the system, the thing that tells you how complicated it is, what level of complexity it can support. That's what we're going to see. And these things are all the order parameters that tell you how complicated it is. Okay, so things like... The number of, you know, creatures, the diversity in a given volume, the number of species, how big it is, and then there's this length scale business that we'll come to. So this is the thing that controls what the ecosystem's doing. These are all things that are telling you how complicated it can be. And it's really just a matter of, I've got an amount of energy coming in, I've got a cost of running a cell, how do I arrange these things to make an ecosystem? And how many different ways can I arrange them is another way of thinking about what we're doing. So that's kind of the answer, but really, I need to unpack it a little bit, so that's what I'll do now. Okay, so I'm going to start and work my way down some of these things. So I won't talk about this for now. I'll start by saying it's uniform. And I'll start by saying there's just one species, okay, and see what happens, and then I'll add some of these things in. That's what I'm going to do. Okay. So the simplest thing I can think of, there's one thing. It's a little red thing, and it's one cell, okay? And they're all uniform, and they're just sitting there in the sea, and the sun is shining, and that's it, okay? And so all you have is the metabolic rate of these things, you have the energy coming in, and you have a density of them. And there's no other variables in the problem, okay? And then if I do this thing, I say, okay, this thing is in a steady state, then the amount of energy these guys use up as a per unit time is just the amount of energy I put in, and I get a relationship like this one. Okay. And so this is telling me, this is my control parameter in the sense that if I crank it up, I can have more of them, and that's all that can happen. And so this gives you the idea that there's a threshold, and this is a lovely quote by Lovelock, where he's basically saying, well, this is like my Reynolds number for life, you know, that if there must be a minimum number of little red things that I need for the system to get going, okay? And if I know what that is, it might be one or one per unit area or whatever it is. But if they maybe need to bump into each other or something. But if I know what that is, that tells me the minimum value of this thing for life to be there at all. And so this is Lovelock's idea about there must be some kind of Reynolds number, and that's what a Reynolds number would look like, okay? So that's the simplest thing, and now I'm just going to make it more complicated, and, you know, I'll run out of time, but you can make it more complicated afterwards. We'll talk to a bit about that. So let's have red and green things. So it's the same. We've just still got one category of little balls, but they are red and green. So I now have two species. Okay, so what do? I say, oh, well, because I only care about the energy they're using, I'll just average, because I don't care that they're red and green in terms of the energetics. So to make this little formula, I just average over all the species and get the average density. Okay, so I still have an equation that looks like this, okay? But there'll be an average of each kind, and there'll be S and L in there. So it starts to get a bit more complicated, okay? And so maybe you can see where this is going. I'm going to say, okay, instead of having them single cell, they're now I've got a particular size. Okay, so but again, I could just work out how many cells are in there so I know what energy they're using up. Okay, and I'll have lots of different ones of different sizes and I can kind of average over each type. So I'm now going to talk about an average density. Okay, that we're average over two things now. So K is labeling the species. So if I'm talking about finches, okay, there are K species of finches. And P tells you they're finches and not elephants. Okay, so the type or the category is P. And so I have to talk about both these things. So for each P, you'll have a different body size. As I say, this is really simple. I'm just saying I'm making them up out of these cells block by block. But of course, you could make this be a sort of more interesting function of P. You could do other things, but just to keep it simple. Okay, so we now have different sized things. Okay, and so the number of, we're introducing more of these parameters now. We've got the Reynolds number type one, which is energy in over energy used per cell, the density, the number of species, and the body size. So if I pick a particular category, I just go out there and measure finches. I measure these things for the finches. So now I want to compare the finches with the foxes or some other thing. I can now, of course, what I want to know is how is this stuff being distributed throughout the ecosystem? Is it all in the finches and just one little fox? Or have we got a ton of foxes and a few finches? How is energy use being distributed in the ecosystem? I need to compare one with the other, okay? And that's what's going on here, okay? So I write this expression down. Now I have to get the density, I have to sum over everything, you know, the different species in each one in the different category. And so I end up with something like this, okay? But what I can do, I mean, okay, I've got these sums, what can I do? I can pull out one particular type. I go and measure the finches. These are the finches. Everything else is kind of now done relative to the finches. And so what I have here is a function. So this function is telling me how you distributed all your energy, all the rate at which you're dumping in this energy. Where did it go in the ecosystem? Is it all in little grasshoppers and finches? How many elephants have you got? You know, how many elephants have you got per finch? You know, how is it distributed? Okay. And it's a dimensionless function, and it's done relative to a kind of my favourite thing, which is the finches, that's these guys in front. And there's your control parameter, the Reynolds number. Okay, so what this thing expresses is the fraction used by these particular guys as compared to the other ones. So this is like my ecosystem thing. And so what I'm going to come to is how could we measure this? I mean, get it from the data, okay? And thus compare ecosystems. And is it always the same or is it different? What makes it different? Okay, so that's that. And then you can keep going. Obviously, as I was saying, you can always put more in and it will just get more complicated. This is the last thing I will do and put in length scale because we meant to do length scale. So just to give you a feel for what happens when you put more in because everybody's interested in length scale. So I didn't worry about where the organisms were in space before. I just kind of uniform density. But this is, of course, not true. So all I do is I say, okay, now I have to introduce another thing. When I look at the density depends on the species. What kind of finch? Is it a blue or a green finch? It depends on whether it's finches or not, and it depends on the length scale over which I counted the finches. Did I count them over a little area or a tree or what? Or a mountain or whatever? So there's an R in here now. So all this is going to do, and the same I have to do for the primary producers, how you got the stuff in, because they're animals too, and so I have to put something in for them. So, okay, it looks like a mess, but all I'm doing is feeding in another, I take an average, just as I did before, and I get another little function out. So just like I got the function for phi, which is telling me, the dimensionless function, which is telling me how body mass and how energy is distributed between big things and small things, how many big things, how many small things, and there was a function, now you're going to get a function in terms of where you are in length scale as well. It's the same idea. So it looks like a mess, but I just end up with a function like this. So the thing to look at is this one. This is my control parameter. So this is like my Reynolds number. It's the energy that I'm supplying per unit time over the rate at which a cell burns it up. Then these are my finches, my favorite things, their density, their diversity, their size or whatever. And then we have the function phi, which tells you where things are distributed in terms of size of things, and the g, which is how they're distributed spatially. So every time you come up with another thing you think is important, you're going to end up with another function like this in the problem, you know, and with an R over L or whatever in there. And you can get more, okay? But then the point is, how can we maybe test? So the next thing is, can we use this to kind of unpack the data? And so as we add these things in, figure out, are they in fact important? Or what ones are important in my ecosystem? You know, what these things are. So that's what I'm going to talk about for the last kind of few minutes. Okay. So first of all, remember I said you have these trends in ecology, and I'm not going to give you the functional forms because I don't know. If I knew the phi or the g, if I knew the g, I would know the species area rule. I'd know the exact thing, right? But I don't. But even without it, it just tells me what's depending on what. Really what it's telling you is that these different rules about species area, latitude gradient, all these things are not interdependent. It tells you how they depend on each other, okay? Because you can see things like, okay, S goes like PL squared, okay? We kind of expect that, you know, that the richness or the diversity will go up if I put more energy into the system. What we're really saying is the more available resource there is, the more complex the system could be, so I can have more diversity. So I could choose, if I kind of double P, you know, the sun's shining, I could shove it all into diversity. I'll have twice as many different kinds of finch. I'll have red and green finches, thank you very much. Or I could have plump finches. They all get twice as fat, okay? Or I could have twice as many finches. And the ecosystem will choose which of these things it does. Okay, and these things are contained in this kind of quantity. So it's telling you how they're... So when we look at the data, we've got to unpack this a lot. It tells you how to do it. So things like that, things like if the metabolic rate grows up, I can't have as much diversity because I can't afford to run as many creatures, basically. And also density, the number that I've got, because density goes like productivity, things of this kind. Okay, latitudinal gradient rules again because you're varying p. So all these things, it kind of tells you where they come from. It's kind of obvious, but I kind of nails it down, okay? Which is maybe useful. Okay. So things like the species area rule. Say you actually want to test for this thing now. This tells you you've got to normalize against the other stuff. So say I want to get this g. All these other guys are varying. I've got to kind of somehow normalize these away. Okay, because I want to know how S depends on G, and I know S will go like, you know, one, you know, L to the D, 2 minus D over this guy, all this lot, okay. I'll shove that over the other side. So I know how that depends on that. It will be something like that. That's my species area rule. But if I measure it, I get all these other things in there. And so we got, this tells you what to do, okay. So, okay, we got all these, so the point is this, if you plot, as these plots do, just things like density, body mass, whatever, species area. If you plot these dimensional quantities, you will see a lot of scatter because you're folding in all the other things. Everything is varying all over the place. So we want to kind of replot these, and that's what I've come here to kind of get, befriend ecologists to give me data to do this. So what you really want to do, species area really, is some, you know, I want to know how S varies. Okay, with G, I want to extract this. So really, I want S, which is the observed species of finches, density, metabolic rate, body mass of finches. The phi, I hope to keep this thing constant or figure it out another way. Productivity and so forth. All that lot lumped together will give me the species area relationship, actually. Okay, so that's the thing I ought to be plotting, not just S on its own. Okay, and this is just a little thing I did on the computer that if I kind of make something that has a nice power law in this guy, okay? And then plug all the other guys in and put a bit of noise on top. You know, if I plot S against L squared, you can roughly see there's something going on. And oh, these are all the other things that I folded in other kinds of noisy trends, but the thing I want is this. So it tells you how to plot your data. Very much like I was showing at the beginning with the Struhol numbers and all these things. You want to plot these kind of quantities to extract out the thing you're interested in. So that's kind of where the kind of interest is. And the same is if you want this ecosystem function. So you say you want to get at the phi, then I've got to normalize for all these other things. Same kind of idea. Okay. And so this is the kind of exciting question. What kind of phis are there? You know, are they all the same? When are they this? Well, probably they're not all the same. But, you know, what classes of them are there and where do they turn up and all this kind of stuff? And if you don't do this, they're going to be kind of buried in the system. And of course, the final point is, so say you do all this and you measure this phi, say you find phi, and then you go back the next year and you find the same phi, and then the next year and you find the same phi, and then you go back another year and it's different. You know, it's telling you that something's wrong, something changed. You know, maybe the ecosystem is changing somehow, that I broke this my assumption that energy is nicely flowing through, the system has chance to adapt, you know, the driving is changing, but it adapts. If you break that, okay, this maybe could be a way of kind of testing it. Okay, so despite all that faffing, I'm almost on time. This is incredible. Okay, so basically, what I've tried to give you is a flavour for something which is used in physics, but it's a kind of general thing. If you've got physical dimensions, you can use this idea of Buckingham Phi theorem. And it tells you lots of different things. It tells you how to plot your data to extract out what you really want. So to sort of, when you've got multiple dependencies in there, it tells you how to do that. Because the multiple dependencies are connected via a constraint. And the constraint here was to do with energy flow, that we identified something. We said that the energy goes in is the energy used up with some fudge factor. And that told us how these things were interdependent, and it allowed us to normalize out stuff and so to know how to plot the data. Okay, it tells you the space, if you want to understand something, and it's moving around a space, so your ecosystem, obviously the sun does not shine the same every day, you know, your ecosystem's moving around in a space. It tells you what the space is, what quantities you plot, like with, I showed with the birds, you know. I could play with these birds forever, this little bird model, but it tells you what actual space you need to explore to get the full dynamics of the system. Okay, and again, it's in terms of these dimensionless parameters. And then there's this idea that we might be able to use it to see when something's catastrophically changing, when you break the thing that I assumed, which was this idea of dynamical steady state, okay? And it completely throws out the idea of equilibrium. There isn't one. And I'll stop.